Afrika kulambuzi diabuli wa mungu Jagala tutambulenga tulibabili fembi Ateya nyali twaukanya
In January 2010, Extending the Link traveled to Uganda to learn about child-headed households.
As students, we went to learn about these children and bring back their stories to share.
Our hope was to inspire compassion and spark interest in lives very different from our own.
But the children touched our lives in more ways than we ever could have expected.
Uganda's a world all of its own. Far away from the familiar landscape of the United States, it ebbs and flows with an abundance of life. But with 76% of Uganda's population living below the international poverty line, survival is becoming a battle, and it is affecting the most vulnerable population, the children.
So parents die, and then children are on their own. Relatives are not out willingly coming to take care of these children because they are many, and the resources are not help. They are not enough to take care of them. So children end up staying on their own. Maybe the elder takes care of the young ones, and there comes the plight of child-headed families.
This child-headed families is a big problem in Uganda. Not only in Uganda, but I think everywhere where we have been a problem of, we have had a problem of AIDS, HIV/AIDS. Because AIDS kills both parents, the mother and the father, leaving the children alone. So you find that sometimes the children are very young to take care of themselves, but they have no choice, they have to do it.
Most of the causes is HIV/AIDS in Africa, in Uganda in particular. And just why you find most of the childhood families in Lakai district where AIDS started from.
Since the first AIDS outbreak in the 1980s, the number of orphaned children has been increasing rapidly. Right now, 50% of the population is under the age of 15. Normally, a member of the extended family would take responsibility for the child if the parents died. However, with more children and fewer resources, the remaining adults cannot afford to care for the orphans. The children are left to fend for themselves, and the burden of supporting and raising a family falls upon the eldest sibling.
But we also don't rule out the issue of conflict, that some parents just leave the children on their own because they have failed to solve problems, and the children still on their own. They have no one, they can't go back to their parents, and they have still on their own, but somehow they have to leave. So that comes and causes child-headed families.
Orphan children can be identified as single or double-parent orphans, depending on how many parents the children have lost. If one parent is lost to AIDS, then it is often the case that the other also has it. Because of this, even children with one parent left alive can still be considered orphans. In the case of AIDS deaths, it is common that the surviving parent will be left physically weak and unable to perform the duties that a parent normally would for their children.
Child-headed families, we have them in different categories. We have the children that don't have parents, they're totally orphans. We have kids that have parents, but they are very sick, so it is kids to take care of those families. And those who are very old and they can't take care of the kids, so it's kids to take care of the parents.
Most parents, even if they are aware of their terminal illness, often cannot make alternate living arrangements for their children before their death. Children are left in the household with limited or no resources. As the epidemic spreads, these child-headed households are becoming more frequent in rural areas. Although poverty and health factors affect everyone, it is the children who bear most of the consequences. At only 15 years old, Nikakwa Rosemary is the primary caretaker of her family. Her father died of AIDS, leaving Rosemary to look after her HIV-positive mother and two young nephews, whom she refers to as her sons.
Where do you sleep?
Sleep.
How many sleep in this room?
Yeah, four.
Yeah.
Na yali taina senta tenga ina obulwadde bwa asima
Nebo muko sabu bingera nze nino kubera nga nze supporting wano we waka ne kusomera.
So the mother went to the hospital and was like admitted there. So should stay here, but at the same time go to nurse the mother. That's what she's saying. So she says that she explained her situation to the administration of Uganda Rural Fund, and then they helped her finish the exams because the mother was sick and was unable to get the money to be able to support her well. So after P7, she continued taking care of the mother. Okay, even after P7, the mother continued to be sick, but was a little improving. Mm-hmm. But still, she went and got her results because they knew her situation. So, and then she finished P7.
Having to act as both mother and nurse requires that she bear responsibilities that are well beyond her years. She is quiet and reserved, but stands straight and speaks with an adult-like confidence. Her weathered hands are an indication of the heavy burdens that she carries, but sometimes she reveals a forgotten childlike nature. At 5 a.m., Rosemary is already awake, taking care of household chores and gardening before beginning a 4-mile walk to school. Although Hope Academy is distant, her teachers say she never misses a class, showing her commitment to receiving an education. When she returns home, Rosemary cares for her family by doing such things as collecting clean water, in addition to doing her homework. There is a nearby ground well that supplies water during the wet season, but for 6 months out of the year, during the dry season, the closest water source is over 9 miles away. Her garden and 2 pigs provide a small income for her family, but it is never enough to cover even the necessities. They often go hungry, and somehow, Rosemary must find enough money to pay for her mother's hospital bills.
She's saying that what motivates her every day is that she knows that suffering is not death, and that this kind of feeling gives her hope. And then she has her friends out there who have suffered but have overcome this kind of suffering. Sometime, like, something good has come out of their suffering. They have become successful. So that makes her wake up and work hard, whatever kind of situation she suffers, because she knows in the future, when she studies, she will be a better person, even when the situation is not appealing.
Costs are high, but Rosemary sacrifices the time and money to go to school because she believes in the value of an education. She also realizes that some children aren't so lucky. In the year 2000, the United Nations set up the Millennium Development Goals to be completed by 2015. One main target is to have universal primary education. Sub-Saharan Africa has the lowest rates of primary school attendance and completion out of any region in the world. This explains why the area also has the lowest literacy rate among ages 15 to 24. The need to eat is often in conflict with the desire for an education, and child-headed families deal with this hardship every day. In a country that is fast becoming a primarily English-speaking area, the lack of an education puts them at an extreme disadvantage. Without this much-needed education, children cannot learn the skills necessary to succeed in daily life. It is inspiring what the children can accomplish when an education is made available to them. Deo Gracias Casigua, known for his bright, sunny personality, brings joy to his peers. He is a social, outgoing character and is never without a smile. He remains optimistic despite the hardships he has had to endure.
Our father died in 2001, but we don't know the disease.
No. Mm-hmm. How did he die?
We don't know because we are still young.
Oh.
But we had a rumor that they had died from HIV, but we are not sure.
Okay.
Yes. And our mother knocked down by a speeding vehicle in 2004.
By a speeding vehicle?
Yeah.
Being the oldest child, he had to adopt the duties of parenthood at a very early age. Deprived of proper nutrition, they would sleep to avoid the constant pains of hunger.
For some time, we used to sleep when we don't eat supper, because we've been taking porridge at school, during school. But now we came here, we don't take lunch. We used to cook porridge for supper.
Okay.
Yeah.
Trying to provide for his family, Deo left for the city to find work. With no legal protection, his employers ended up paying him less than $10 a year.
I went in Kampala and I worked as a houseboy.
Oh, really?
For 4 years.
Wow.
But I was still young. And they refused to pay me because I worked for 4 years, but they gave me only 70,000 shillings.
Wow.
Yeah.
In 4 years?
Yeah, in 4 years.
Without any money and living in a deteriorating house, Deo built his family a new home using nothing but mud and sticks. Now 19 years old, Deo supports his family by farming maize, coffee, and bananas, and also has a small brick-making cooperative with a few of his friends. He is a natural entrepreneur and leader, but he still finds it difficult to balance schoolwork with generating an income and providing food for his family.
I'm working hard so that we can get constant food, but...
So he's rented the land, so he's negotiated with the landowner. He's hired 3 or 4 laborers, and he's paying them on a per shilling, per brick basis. Then he hires someone to bake the bricks. He transports them to market. This whole process, he makes a profit of about 200,000 shillings, so $100 in 3 months. In between running this business, he's managing a field of crops. So he's planting seeds, planting maize, and somewhere between all these businesses, he's managing to study as well. I mean, if I was as hardworking and motivated as Deo is, I'd be Prime Minister of Australia by now, I think. He's a really special guy.
Deo, along with Rosemary, are two of the children identified and helped by Uganda Rural Fund's Child-Headed Households Program, which works in conjunction with the Hope Integrated Academy. The goal of Hope Academy is to try to give children who don't have much the opportunity of an education. They have a dedicated staff who commit themselves to the betterment of children throughout the area. The school is funded by Uganda Rural Fund, or URF, and they do their best not only to educate, but to use the school as a means to identify child-headed households and improve the quality of life for these children. They do this by helping them buy land, pay for an education, and provide better food and housing. They also provide opportunities for outside volunteers to get involved. People get involved through the URF website and fly out to Uganda to get a first-hand experience of meeting with these amazing children. And the children get the experience of meeting people with lives very different from their own. The work done by these volunteers serves to inspire the students as well as to give them an outlet to practice their English. The people who work at Hope Academy realize the importance that an education has for these children, and they are devoted to providing the necessary facilities for the children to learn.
These students need your encouragement, very important. Encouragement that they are not the only ones, and some of this not the end of life. That is very important. And also to like advise them. Somehow they're like, they get a little strained with the resources and they're like, they are giving up. I'm not the parent, these are only my brothers and sisters. Maybe I can't manage a parent role. So they need encouragement, basically, from you.
We need certain such things, like, there's time that we want to be having parents, guardians, and we need to take care of ourselves. Many people come to me and say, I have a problem, I don't have fees, and I want to be at school. They say, yes, you want to be at school, but what have you done for yourself to be at school? You need to make a contribution to your life. You need to do something, however small it is, but you need to do something.
What's really struck me is how motivated they are to better themselves and better their situation. You've got 8-year-old kids who, on their vacations between the school years, every day they're studying the syllabus for the next year. They're that motivated to do well. And that is something that's just so different from what I've seen in the West. You know, kids, they skive off every opportunity they get. But here, it seems any break in the working day, they study. I think, generally speaking, there needs to be more government support. They need more funding. They need more social welfare. Whether or not that's going to be forthcoming is another question.
The population of Uganda is maybe over 50% is children below the age of 15. That means that the government has to do the donkey work to ensure that schools are built, to ensure that enough food is produced for the children, to ensure that guidance is given. So actually, as a government is a parent, so government has to take care of all these children. But you know, it's something which is very, very, very pleasing. We are happy that we are doing that, but it requires a lot of work.
Education isn't just about becoming a doctor or a lawyer. It's about broadening your modes of thinking. It's about learning how to reason. It's about basic arithmetic and basic language skills. I mean, these are the things that we learn in primary school and high school.
The more the child understands, the more the child gets to know that this is bad, in terms of especially, like if a child read about the causes of the deaths of the parents, like HIV, the child would be careful to take care of himself, not to misbehave in terms of like meeting wrong partners.
This will help them be able to create issues, to create their own solutions of the problems. So at HOPE, what we do is that holistic and integrated education that will help them be able to pass through the world, which has threats, but as well, they are able to identify the opportunities. Yeah.
Basic arithmetic, for example, is as important to a maize farmer as anything. You know, when he takes his crops to market, he needs basic accounting skills. So to say, oh, there's no point going to high school if you're not going to get into college, is completely fallacious.
In this modern society, when you don't have education, you can't get anything, because nowadays you see everything, they are using computers to do everything, but when you don't have education, you can't use that machines.
I'm going to guide them in knowing their own issues and finding like manageable solutions based on where they are, from their home environment and the school environment. And so it's like I'm going to act as a mirror to them, showing them what they can do.
I think I'm going to sponsor some children because now I've been here, I can see the need. I can see that the money is actually going to be used for something good. Giving to URF isn't like giving to a faceless multinational charity where you never see where the money goes. So yeah, I'm going to go back to Australia, resume my career, donate some money, and come back and see how things go in a few years. Yeah.
Hush now, baby, don't you cry. Rest your wings, my butterfly. Peace will come to you in time, and I will sing this lullaby. No, though I must leave my child, that I would stay here by your side. And if you wake before I'm gone, remember that sweet lullaby. And oh, don't you ever stop believing.
Uganda and the people who live there have left a permanent mark on us.
Each student is a friend, each volunteer, a mentor.
Our experiences of these children and the school will remain imprinted on us for years to come.
It now becomes our duty to share their lives and struggles and make the same impact on you that they made on us.